RPG Chick back with another dungeon delving episode of Let's Play Pillars of Eternity Blind. But before we delve in some more, I'm going to read a couple books that we found here. And then we're going to move around. We're going to move around here. I don't know about that. We could probably get through there, but I'd rather see what's in this open area first. So we've got the Great Western Stag. One day, Eothas was sitting on a wall, watching a cat play in the sun. A crystal hung in a nearby tree had fragmented a sunbeam and scattered small motes of light on the ground. They danced around the cat, sliding over him as he frantically batted at them. He spun in place, following one as it rushed past him, and leapt on it, trying to pin it down. Eothas smiled, amused at the animal's tenacity. The cat landed on a spot, placing his paws over it, only to watch it flit away again. Eothas watched the cat's tail twitch and slap at the ground, annoyed that his prey could not be pinned. Whoops. "Why must you tease him?" a voice said from behind him, accompanied by the crunch of sandals on gravel. "I merely bring the dawn," Eothas responded. "I don't stoke the hunter's heart. That's your responsibility, isn't it?" "True," said a second voice, "but neither do you quell it. If the hunter could not see his prey, would he still hunt?" "So philosophical, Hylia," Eothas said, and turned to greet the two gods that approached him. "Have you come to debate the parallel between sight and desire?" He gestured to the wall, inviting Hylia and Galloway to join him. They sat in silence, watching the cat, who continued to hunt the sun, fruitlessly swatting at another mote and then rolling onto his back. "I have created the ultimate prey," Eothas said finally, breaking the silence. "It can be tracked, it can be followed, it can be seen, but it can never be caught." Galloway laughed lightly. "You don't agree, Galloway?" Eothas asked. "While it's true that your creation is elusive, it hardly can be considered the ultimate prey because it never can be caught." He paused, his brow furrowed in thought. "If that mode of light had substance, the hunter could subdue it. Otherwise, it's merely a dream, truly a fruitless endeavor." "All creatures spend their life chasing fruitless endeavors," said Hylia. "It is the way of mortality." Galloway laughed again. "I could create a creature, a living creature of flesh and blood, that could never be caught. I make your dream a reality." Now it was Eothas' turn to laugh. "You propose turning a fruitless dream into a fruitless reality? How is this any better?" "A life spent in the pursuit of an attainable goal far exceeds any other." "But you just said no one could catch this creature. This is not attainable." Galloway smiled. "Humanity has surprised us before. Indeed, it could surprise us again. I will create a great white stag and I will set it free in the world. It will have grace, reliance, and tenacity. It will exist solely to pursue for all its days, and it will never be caught. It will serve to inspire the hunt for generations to come. All those who wish for glory will invoke my name. All those who hear its story will ask for my blessing in finding it." Hylia shook her head and threw Galloway a bemused look. "I do not believe this is possible. So I, too, make an offer. To the person who catches this stag, and they will catch the stag, I will bestow upon them its grace, resilience, and tenacity. Thrice blessed they will be. They will ask for my blessing on the hunt, so they can obtain my boon." Galloway and Hylia took up arguing whose name would be invoked more when the hunt was on. Eothas sighed, a small smile playing at the edges of his mouth. He stood and looked to the sky. The sun had already started to hide itself behind the mountains. The cat, long ago tired of the stalking of the motes, had fallen asleep beneath a tree. He turned and looked at the other gods, deep in debate, and sighed again. "I merely bring the dawn," he repeated as he made his way down the path. "It is up to you to see what I reveal." Okay, that's one. And then the Book of Verses. This small volume of verses and psalms is somewhat battered, suggesting it used to be carried on someone's person. The pages are dog-eared and worn, and the gold threads, which form the title of the book, have begun to fray. The book tends to open to a particular section, where someone has marked a verse with a small blotch of ink. Eadnong, the bright star, spoke, and her voice was like a clarion cry, calling his soul forth. He knew her for the right hand of the shining god, and he was afraid. O wanderer, hear me, she spoke. You are known to us, and your deeds put you far from salvation. And he wept, for he knew that his sins lay bare before this great illumination. Then Sargamus spoke, and his voice swept forth with the heat and force of the bright day sun. Weep not, for the child of light has forgiveness even for you, if you will embrace him. Harmki knelt before them, then resolved to save himself, and asked what he must do. And Modigun spoke. Her voice was like the songbird's final hymn, bidding farewell to the day's light. What darkness lies within you, you must cast into his light. Your sins will be burned from you, until you are newly formed, reborn into his keeping. So spoke Modigund, but Eadnung warned him, saying, You have walked all these years into darkness, and must now return. You will find the path like treading fire, and at every step you will be tempted to turn away. But no harm will come to you if you keep your faith. Okay. So that's those two books. I wonder if we're going to find a lot of duplicates of books like Skyrim. I said like Skyrim. Okay, I know there's that there, but I'm going to come around this way. We've been through here, this dining hall.
Nice and quiet.
I hear water. What manner of beasties lurk within? Oh my god. Weakened. When a character's health bar begins flashing red as a sign that they may soon be maimed or killed, rest at an inn or use camping supplies to fully restore health.
I feel off.
Wow.
Time to see and not be seen.
Is it still trapped?
Aye?
Yeah.
I don't know if it's still trapped. How do we tell? Yeah, if health reaches zero, character will immediately be dropped. I believe we're maimed with our settings. Pillars of Eternities, there's no coming back. There's no, revive spell, resurrection spell. Let me save, because I don't know if this is still trapped. It isn't, okay. Ooh, we've got a minor ring of protection. Good price. So we've read about rings in general. This just tells about rings in general. Plus 5 fortitude, reflex, and will, all three. And a garnet. Garnets come in nearly every color, but are most frequently pictured as being red or orange. On the rare side of Eora stones, garnet is also known for its hardness and is occasionally employed by certain blacksmiths in steel etching. Now, instead of using camping supplies, can we cast one of his spells? Combat only. Yeah, it's not really good for... It might be a way of checking traps. checking to see something's trapped. I just have to find out how to do that, really. I'm surprised. It looks just like a normal box. All right. This ring. Now she has the Gaunt's Pledge. She can also wear this ring. Let's have him wear it. He dies really quickly in combat. And he seems to be getting hurt. We're gonna head in here next, but I think we should camp. Okay, we're good.
Got it.
A scolder, regular scolder. Oh, it's not exactly what I wanted to do. Lance. Let's see if this will work. If it moves quickly enough.
Aye?
Oh boy.
Lava will be on sea.
I don't want him to be soloing this thing. Oh boy, there's so many. Mind blades. Up to 5 targets. Nice. I like that. Not enough focus. Wait. Okay. No, wrong person.
How may I help?
By killing our foes. Okay. Just attack. Fan of flames. Oh yeah. Cast it, hurry up. Nice. Get rid of this guy. That. Oh wait, that guy fell. Come on. Good. Oh. Who are you?
Quickly and quietly.
Who's the ghostie? Another spirit. A haze fills the air, coalescing steadily into a blur of dust and mist. It gathers into the outline of what appears to be a dwarf, a shimmering echo that fades in and out of sight. But stronger than sight is the sense within you of a powerful energy. It roils and seethes with a grief that seems to spill into your own thoughts, tainting them until the sorrow is your own. Like a crashing wave, the energy surges towards and into you, and suddenly you are elsewhere. Before you is a brightly lit stone corridor, lined with torches and gleaming crystals. You are running, your footsteps echoing off the stone around you. You forgot to tie your sandals, and they're slipping from your feet, fouling your steps. You're late. Again. The rite's going to begin without you. You hear the tolling of a bell, and your spirits lift as you recognize the familiar, warped tone of the right hand, representing the first of the dawn stars to appear in the night sky and last to fade in the dawn light. You pray fiercely that this is the first of the chimes and not the last. The lights fade, as does the memory, and when your eyes clear, the spirit is gone. Addendum added, buried secrets. Addendum to it. I don't see an addendum. Find the dwarf woman from the dream.
Yeah.
Wow, okay. So we're all right. Good to see it.
Time to see and not be seen.
Ears. A powerful odor of spices rises from one of these dishes. Vibrant dyes and grain seeds fill the others. How do I check if this is trapped? It's not good. A stiletto and 4 copper skeets. Let's make sure there's nothing else going on in here.
Are peeled.
That sounds painful. Saving. Okay. So actually, apparently, unless there's a secret wall or something like that, besides that one. This is the only area we haven't uncovered. Oh. What are these addendums? Oh, here we go. I have seen some manner of spirit within the temple, or a memory at least. In this memory, I recalled an Eothiasian rite involving the ringing of bells. The first and last of these tolls apparently is that of the right hand, which has a distinctive warped tone to it. The door to the lower floor appears to be sealed with some sort of enchantment. There is a set of bells beside the door which may play a part in opening it. Unless... I doubt I can do that.
I'll have it in no time. I'll have it in no time.
Sure you will.
I'll see what I can do.
Eh? This won't stop me for long.
You are way too confident.
Why not? Why not? This won't stop me for long.
Alright.
No problem.
I didn't think we had a chance with that. Three bells hang from the stone protrusion that runs along this wall. Years of dust and grime coat the metal. There is one large bell in the center, flanked by two smaller ones. Yes. Examine. The bells appear to be fully intact. They are made of a thick iron and look very heavy. There doesn't appear to be much out of the ordinary about them. Ring the left bell. The bell tolls a high, piercing note of startling power. The tone echoes merrily through the halls, until it seems that a dozen chirping notes ring through the temple. I hope we kill everything in here first. How about the right smaller bell? The bell sounds a strange, warbling peal that grows to a painful shrillness before it diminishes to a mournful chime. And the middle large bell. Boom. You heave at the bell and it swings back in the other direction. The clapper strikes a low, powerful note against the heavy iron. You feel the ringing in your chest as the sound moves through the ruined halls in a rolling tide. Be cool if we could click on the bells as well. I don't know. Ring the middle bell again. A deep resonating peal echoes through the ruins. Did we do it right the first time? A strange hush falls upon the room, muting the sound of the bells and the eternal drip of damp stone alike. And then, a sudden dissonant toll sounds from the bells, so loud and piercing that you are compelled to cover your ears. And then, at last, silence once more. Well, that wasn't it. Alright, so it's just combinations. I see no... Unless something else we found... Second bell. Hold on. The first and last of these tolls apparently is that of the right hand, which has a distinctive warped tone to it. That's the right bell, isn't it? How many rings are there? Total. First and last, right, they said? first and last. I'm trying to ring them. The peculiar chime rings through the ruins. You reach out to hold the clapper still. Around you, the echoes diminish. It says it's warbling, not warped. I think that's the warped one. Okay, so right, left, right.
I'll have it in no time.
Right. Middle. Right. There's a quiet melodic chime from all three bells before their discordant voices meet in one powerful rising rush of sound. It seems to fill the whole of the temple, a driving flood of song that drowns all other thought. Aha! As the tolling fades, you hear a creak from the direction of the doors as the passage to the lower level swings open. Hey, hey.
I shall be discreet.
Descending. Heavier armor grants more protection, but extends recovery for its wearers. Indeed. Quest updated. I have descended into the lower level of the temple. If Wharton spoke true, then the remains of the murdered priests are down here somewhere. A shadow? Oh boy. I know like. I don't think corrosive things will work on that either. He can't see it from there.
Yes?
Better or worse. amplified, whatever.
Hi.
He's already down 2x2, which is good. I'm not pulling any punches with these things. Mind wave? What's gonna hit? What's his name? And what else can we use on this thing? Oh, that wasn't bad. I'm thinking about shadows from D&D, they're pretty bad.
No prob-
Oh, I'm not sneaking.
Problem.
What's this? What is that? Nothing in here. There's a door here and a door here. Interesting, very interesting.
How may I help?
It's no good, he's got no uses left of anything. Got arcane assault.
Eh?
And all hers are per encounter. I don't know. We might be able to defeat something.
Eh?
Eh? Hmm? Okay. Thanks for watching. Stay tuned when we explore more of the second level of the Temple of Eothas. See you next time in a Bang Bang Boogie, and don't stop the boogie.